All right, I think I am live here. This is a little bit different, so I'm really going to need all of your feedback. I am recording live from my home here in Lethbridge, Alberta. I had some technical difficulties. I'm actually outside enjoying the beauties of my backyard. There's a little bit of wind, but I want all of you who are tuning in to who are actually watching this to give me some feedback on the audio. So we're going to do a little bit of a beta test here. So if there's anyone who's actually watching this, let me know if you can hear me okay or if I need to do something else. And you know, with respect to the audio, this is a completely new experiment for me. So anybody that's watching, let me know how the audio is. Can you hear me okay? So I'm just waiting for a little bit of feedback. There might be some wind issues too. So this is Lethbridge, so you can imagine the wind here. Anyone who knows southern Alberta will realize that it is not great, and it blows a lot. So if you're watching this, just let me know if you can hear me okay. I see we've got people now starting to watch. So if I can just get some feedback here. I'm trying to look at the comments, and I'm recording this live on my... Okay, we've got a comment there that I don't understand. Suresh. It looks like it's Arabic or something. I can't read that one. How's the audio with our beta test here? Deepali, how are you? Can you guys hear me okay? Just give me a thumbs up if you can hear me okay. I'm just waiting for some feedback here. So, Deepali Sharma, can you hear me okay? I'm just waiting for a little confirmation from everyone. I'll just send out a little text here. Okay, Deepali says, I am good. Can you hear me okay? Yes, okay, we're in business. I have one confirmation. Awesome that you guys can hear me. So fantastic. All right, so today is a beautiful early morning, June the 15th, I believe it is. Let's take a quick look here. Yeah, the 15th, and we're recording this live from my home in Lethbridge, Alberta. I am gratefully happy to do this for you guys once again, but I had to do some accommodation because my daughter has her choir, final school choir performance tonight, and it was starting at 6:30, so I had no option but to either reschedule this or do it in the morning. So because it's such a beautiful day out, I thought I would do it outside here. So there's a couple things that I wanted to cover today, and right off the bat, I want to acknowledge once again that all of these Express Entry live Q&As are sponsored by the Canadian Immigration Institute, which I'm the founder of, and our very first course on Express Entry, our step-by-step guide to doing it yourself, essentially. And it's a video guide, and in past videos, Q&As, live Q&As, I've given you a little bit of an overview of what that course is. I'll put a link to it so you can access it in the comments, but that is the title sponsor. So thank you to the Express Entry do-it-yourself guide there, that step-by-step guide I created. All right, I want to also let you know that I just returned back from a phenomenal conference in Toronto. It was our National Immigration Law conference with the Canadian Bar Association. And last year, I was on the panel with the government officer speaking and presenting on Express Entry. This year, I got a little bit of a break, so I was actually pretty happy about it. I was able to attend a lot of different sessions. I didn't need to stress over my presentation, and I learned a lot, and I was able to reconnect with some of the government officers. And so it was a wonderful conference, not only just about Express Entry, but all aspects of Canadian immigration. So I was able to reconnect with the officers, ask some pretty interesting questions, and renew those relationships that I had from last year. So I'm going to share a little bit about that in this Q&A. I can't remember who it was in our last Q&A, that I would talk a little bit about the Federal Skilled Trade Program. And as most of you who are following the rounds of invitations for Express Entry really closely, you will remember that two rounds of invitations ago, there was a draw that was targeted specifically to the Federal Skilled Trade Program. And in fact, invitations for 400, if I can get my fingers out there, 400 invitations to apply, ITAs, were given out. And the lowest score was actually under 200 comprehensive ranking system points. So under 200. But only those who were eligible to qualify under the Federal Skilled Trade Program were actually given ITAs. So some of you may have had 300 or more points, but you were your eligibility was under the Federal Skilled Worker Program, not the Federal Skilled Trade. So I promised that individual that I would explain the Federal Skilled Trade Program, how it works, so that people would know, if you are working in a trade abroad, what you need to do to qualify. Now, with the wind blowing here, my hair, I've got gel in it, so you can't see the wind blowing. I had my pages. Part of the reason I was a little bit late getting started is that my pages blew away here. So now I've tried to pin them down with a little binder here to hold the pages from drifting away. But I think I've got everything taken care of now. So like we talked about, with Express Entry, you must meet the eligibility requirements for one of the three programs. The Federal Skilled Worker Program, most of the time, if you're outside of Canada, that's the one you're going to qualify through. Or the Canadian Experience Class, which is if you're working and you've got Canadian work experience in Canada, at least 1 year. And then finally, the Federal Skilled Trade Program. Because usually trade-level workers are not going to have a PhD in astrophysics. They're not going to have that education, and that usually is one of the main determiners of whether or not you can qualify through Express Entry. They don't get credit for it. And so because of that, and their language scores are often a little bit lower as well, so because of that, Canada needs tradespeople. And so that's why they created the Federal Skilled Trade Program. So let's take a quick look at what the requirements really are, okay? So right off the bat, with most of Express Entry, you have to plan to live outside of the province of Quebec. And that's obviously just because Quebec's got their own programs, their own rules, and their own deal, I guess you could say, with the federal government in terms of how they immigrate people to the province of Quebec. But the starting point is that as a federal skilled trade worker, you must meet the minimum language level that's set out for that Federal Skilled Trade Program. And it's actually lower than what is required for the Federal Skilled Worker Program. The Federal Skilled Worker Program, you need a Canadian language benchmark of at least 7. But with the Federal Skilled Trade Program, those requirements are softened. So all you need is a level 5 for speaking and listening, and a level 4 for reading and writing. So that's quite a bit lower. So the English language standard has been dropped a lot. So that's the first thing. Then you need to make sure that you have at least 2 years of full-time work experience in a skilled trade. So we're talking about, what are trades? Well, welders, pipe fitters, carpenters, auto mechanics, heavy-duty mechanics, all of these trade-level positions. And if you go to the government website, it will break down, and it's all at a skill level B on the National Occupational Classification System, and you use the 2011. But at that level, all of those skill level B trade positions, you have to have at least 2 years of work experience in those trades in the previous 5. this is an interesting way of doing it. So 2 years of skilled trade work experience in the previous 5 years before you're eligible to apply. Then you also have to meet the job requirements of that skilled trade. So many of you have already had a chance to look at some of the blogs that I've written. You've had a chance to listen to some of the previous Q&As that I've done on work experience. But it's the same thing as all of the other standard requirements for other people who are getting their work experience qualified. You must have performed all of the activities in the lead statement under the National Occupational Classifications position profile. So if you're a welder, then you need to perform all of the activities listed in the lead statement, as well as all of the essential duties and a substantial number of the main duties listed for that trade. And it's important to note that you do not need to have an actual trade certification. So even though within the National Occupational Classifications profile description, it lists for requirements, employment requirements, that you often need trade certification in a particular Canadian province to practice or work in that occupation. For the purposes of express entry and the federal skilled trade program, you don't need that. So you don't need your actual trade certification. It's not mandatory. Now, it may come into play later. Maybe you are working in Canada, but at this stage, what you have to realize is that it's all of the duties in the lead statement, all of the activities in the lead statement, and a substantial number of the main duties. So that's what you need to show that you've met those qualifications. Now, the final thing is that you have to have an offer of full-time of employment for a total period of at least 1 year. So this is the final component. So a Canadian company who says, I will offer you a job offer, and that's usually linked to a labor market impact assessment or a certificate of qualification in that skilled trade issued by a Canadian province. So the final component is that you actually need to have one of two things, either an offer of employment from a company or alternatively trade certification. Now, most times you're not going to be able to get that trade certification unless you're actually in Canada. And so to a large extent, the government is giving an advantage to people who are already in Canada, working in Canada. But if you have a Canadian company who is willing to extend a job offer to you, then you can use that as the final piece of the requirements. So that's basically it. And I know many of you are probably rolling your eyes thinking, here we go again. How in the world am I going to get a job offer from a Canadian company? And that's fair. But I want you all to understand that the Canadian economy is slowly starting to recover. And when I started practice back in 2003, 2004, Alberta, the province I'm in, was booming. In fact, our unemployment rate in the province was less than 3%, which basically means full employment. You could get labor market impact assessments in almost every single industry because there were simply not enough Canadians and Albertans to do the jobs. And that's everything from food service all the way to the oil and gas industry, to trades, to all these positions. But when we experienced the global recession that started kind of 2009, 2010, then that's when everything changed. So understand that although now it's pretty discouraging because there are simply not many job openings in Canada. Heck, there are not many job openings in Canada for Canadians. The reason for that is because of the economic situation. But Canada will rebound. We have an awesome country, and like many other countries in the world, we will rebound. And when that happens, then Canadian companies will once again be looking at bringing in workers, not just skilled, but even low-skill workers from abroad. So that's that's kind of the situation. So that's the Federal Skilled Trades Program. Hopefully that was helpful. Now I want to shift to, I've had a ton of questions that came in. I'm not going to be able to get to all of them, but I did want to go over some of the high points of the things that I learned from directly from the government officers at our National Canadian Bar Association Immigration Law Conference. So that was just this past weekend. All right. So I had a chance, like I said, to speak with the officers after and reconnect with them. But during the session, I'm going to pull out just a number of high points just for you guys. Now, I don't want this to last too long, this Q&A, but there's a lot to cover here. And hopefully everybody will be able to hear me okay. So right off the bat, the officer acknowledged that there probably would not be draws within the next couple weeks, because anytime they make changes within the Express Entry portal, it takes time for those changes and additional points, like for the siblings, points for siblings, points for French language. It takes time for those changes to actually reflect on your individual profiles. And so they didn't want to start issuing ITAs until they had that all sorted out. So it's likely going to be a couple weeks before we actually see the next invitation to apply. Now, anything could happen. Maybe the computer will get things sorted out and it will happen sooner. But those changes should start to be reflected in your profiles now. Now, I also wanted to point out that there are huge issues with the government's online filing system. Massive issues. They did an update a couple weeks back, and now applications are getting lost and they're disappearing, especially from our employer portals and anyone filing online applications. So it is a mess. So you need to understand that there's going to be a little bit of opposition, I guess, if you will, when you're trying to get your application submitted, even if it's for something other than Express Entry, maybe a temporary resident visa application or a work permit application. So I just thought I'd share that with you as well. Okay, police clearances. This is something that's really important. For most permanent resident applications or for most temporary resident applications in Canada, you have to show, if you have lived continuously in one country since turning the age of 18, for over 6 months, then you are going to, you're going to have to provide a police clearance. But with Express Entry, it's cumulative. What that means is if you visited a country over a 10-year period, more than 6 months, and you've had multiple trips there, then that could require you to provide a police clearance. So you need to make sure that if there's a chance that you have spent more than 6 months cumulatively, when you add up all the days over the past 10-year period, then it's possible that you could require police clearance for that country. So you need to pay attention to that if you're a business traveler who's spending a lot of time out of country. Now, as I'm doing this this live Facebook video, I noticed that I didn't plug in my iPad, so the battery is actually starting to go down. So I'm going to stop this recording just for a few seconds for me to get a cord and to plug in, and then I'll reconnect. So hang tight for just 1 second, and I'll be back with you in just a moment.